Yeah, so good morning, everybody. I would like to start by thanking the college and Paul for bringing me to this very diverse meeting. It's very interesting to see sports science from so many angles, and I'm thrilled that we can all be in one room together still, but let's see how it goes. What I hope to convince you of is that there is a memory not only in the brain, but a cellular memory also residing in the muscle cells. Now, memory is certainly also in the brain a cellular, as far as we understand it, a cellular phenomenon. I think long-term potentiation, LTP, is the best candidate for that, which is a prolonged boosting of synaptic effects. And classically, memory consists of an encoding phase, learning, and then the information is stored, and then it can be retrieved. In terms of muscle, the encoding would be a first training period, and then somehow the information about that training is stored in the muscle, and then it is retrieved or made visible, brought to light by a retraining program. Before I venture into muscle memory, I would point out to you some peculiarities about the end product of sport, if you like, which is movement of a muscle fiber, muscle cell. And a muscle cell, they are very special in several ways. So they are by far, far the largest cell in the body. You might have read that the egg is the largest cell in the mammalian body. That's not true, it's the muscle. A sartorius fiber, for example, in a human can be more than 40 centimeters long, more than 50 micrometers in diameter, and it could have a volume of more than 1,000 nanoliters. And compared to body cells, as you see there, that is very, very, very large. And it's larger than the ovum, and it's even larger than another large cell, the motor neuron. The motor neuron might span longer distances. It could be more than a meter from the spinal cord down to the foot. The motor neuron has devised an elaborate transport system, axonal transport, to transport products back and forth from the cell body to the nerve ending. And in the cell body, there is a sole nucleus that is sort of the governor of that cell. Similar transport systems have not been described in the large muscle cells, and they have a different strategy for coping, and that is by being multinuclear. So now this is a human vastus lateralis rendered in a confocal image, but if it was a sartorius fiber, it could contain maybe 40,000 cell nuclei in one cell. And in fact, muscle is one of the few multinuclear fusion sites that you find in the mammalian, less than a handful in the mammalian body. Now, if you take a closer look at these nuclei, they are not randomly spaced. They're placed in the muscle fiber. They seem to be evenly spaced out in the muscle fiber. And this seems to be important. So this is a paper from Bailey's group from the Drosophila larva, where they also the Drosophila larva has this very ordered positioning of the cell nuclei in their muscle fibers. And they knocked out MAP7, and that leads to perturbation of the order. And they show then that this impaired crawling behavior in the larva. So it seems to be functionally important. We believe that this is related somehow to each nucleus covering a certain part of the cell. And at the top there, you see nuclei in a fiber as they are placed in reality. And then we take the same nuclei and place them randomly. And as you can see, then lacuna here appears. There are then parts of the cytoplasm that is very far from a nucleus. It has been known for quite a number of years now that each nucleus sort of serves a local region that is true both for organelles surrounding the nucleus related to protein synthesis and also some of the proteins that are produced by that machinery and from that particular nucleus. And even back to the 1800s, it has been discussed that each nucleus can serve only, or can support, if you like, only a certain cytoplasmic volume. And this has been called the domain volume, the nuclear domain volume. And an hypothesis in the strictest form says that this is constant, this is a constant volume. Each nucleus will support a constant volume. And there are some consequences of that, and one is that if you go from small to large fiber or the other way around, then the number of nuclei would need to change. So if you double the volume, you need to double the number of nuclei. So is this empirically true? Is it like that? And the answer, I think, is both yes and no. And without spending too much time on it, there is, in this case, these are 2 months old mice, a correlation between size and the number of nuclei. It varies between muscles how sort of steep that correlation is, but there is a correlation. At least larger fibers seems to have more nuclei. Now, that is, even that is not always true. So this is 14 months old mice. And you see here is very little correlation between size and the number of nuclei. So, and I'll come back to that. So these muscles that have sort of lived a life for a while, it don't seem, at least not strictly, seem to follow this idea of a constant minuclear domain. And this brings me to sort of, I think, a characteristic of this field, and that is that it has been controversial. And I think one of the reasons it has been controversial is that it's hard to identify minuclei, or it's hard to distinguish them from other nuclei within the muscle tissue. And I would remind you that only 60% of the nuclei in the muscle tissue, it's complex tissue, are minuclei. The rest are other cell types, connective tissue, blood vessels, etc. And that's something to think about if you are a biochemist and are grinding up muscles and measuring various factors. And I think even at the histological level, this has been problematic. I think we recently improved that somewhat for by characterizing an antibody against a protein called PCM1. And as you can see, that will stain minuclei only. So the ones that are inside the muscle fiber here will be stained. Those that are between muscle fibers, outside muscle fiber, will not be labeled by this particular antibody. So I think this is going to be helpful. Now, most of what I'm going to show to you today is not done by this technique. It's done by a technique that I think is even more precise, and it's, for us at least in our lab, is a gold standard, and that is in vivo imaging, where you can observe the nuclei within the living cell. And in principle, this is very simple. We put mice under the microscope, and we inject single cells with micropipettes, and we use a nuclear dye, and then we can label the nuclei and only those nuclei that is inside the sarcolemma of this particular cell. And we can do this time-lapse-wise by suturing the animal back up again and come back hours, days or weeks, even weeks later, as I'll show you examples of. Now, I think that you would have to agree with me when it comes to regulating muscle mass, this has been the textbook model. And the textbook model says that when you go from a thin fiber with few nuclei and the fiber, then when there is an hypertrophic stimulus, could be exercise, strength exercise, for example, then satellite, the fiber grow and satellite cells will multiply, stem cells of the muscle, and fuse with the fiber so that you produce a fiber with many nuclei, a thick fiber with many nuclei. And then the idea has been that when you stop training or have an atrophy condition, then you lose these extra nuclei by an apoptosis within the intact cell. And then you end up exactly where you started, a thin fiber with few nuclei. Now, I would like to point out that this is a system or a model without the memory. You end up exactly where you started. You can go back and forth between these two states, and there's no, at least no apparent difference. There's no memory, there's no hysteresis in the system. So we were very interested in this dynamics of nuclei, and we wanted to study it. In particular, we thought it was very interesting to look at these apoptotic nuclei and which of them apoptotic, etc. So we wanted to use our in vivo imaging technique on it, and we were very surprised by the result. And this is an example. So this is a fiber at day zero on the top there. And at that time, the muscle was denervated, which leads to muscle wasting. And then 3 weeks later, we came back to the same fiber. And as you can see under there, it is thinner. But if you count the nuclei within the segment, the synapse there is in red as a marker, you can see that there's 21 nuclei on the top and there is 21 nuclei on the second image. So you don't lose a single nucleus. And we saw that in the number of fibers, in spite of a rather pronounced atrophy. There were virtually none or almost no change in the number of nuclei. So we think that, and we've shown that now in a variety of atrophy conditions. I mentioned innervation. We have shown it for TTX block. We have shown it for antagonist ablation. We have shown it for hind limb suspension. We have shown it for detraining. And recently unpublished, we have seen it in cancer cachexia. We see apoptosis in the tissue. So apoptosis goes up in the tissue that is atrophying. But the apoptosis seems to be confined to non-myonuclei. That are the other cells in the muscle, satellite cells and other cells in the muscle. So there's an increase in apoptosis, and you will see that on biochemical markers, but the myonuclei seems to be protected against apoptosis. So I think basically that part of the model is wrong. How about the other part? Of course, when you find one problem, there might be others. And I'm happy to say that there we seem to confirm at least the major part of the model. So to make a long story short, yes, when you go from a thin fiber to thick fiber, you get more myonuclei. It was at variance with existing literature that we see that the myonuclei from satellite cells, they precedes the muscle growth in time, suggesting or hinting that there might be a causal relationship there. So this, I think, is basically okay. Now, another controversy and a very long-standing debate in the field has been whether you can shortcut this system. And the idea has been that, you often see additional myonuclei from satellite cells, but you can also go up with sort of another route and get a large fiber with not so many nuclei. So this, the satellite cells, the addition of more myonuclei are not, it's not obligatory, has been the idea. And there's a large literature on this, but a recent paper that kind of interested us to the extent that we try to reproduce it was this paper from Charlotte Peterson's group, where the title says that they have effective fiber hypertrophy in satellite cells depleted skeletal muscle. And they say that there is a robust hypertrophy that is not dependent on satellite cells or getting more myonuclei. With a very similar model, it's a mouse model where satellite cells are ablated with the genetic technique, transgenic mice. And we did not see any hypertrophy when we overloaded muscles where the satellite cells had been ablated. So the only condition in red here where we saw a shift towards larger fibers were when the satellite cells were there and when we overloaded If you overload it without the satellite cells, it was no change. So this led to a rather heated debate, I should say, and I'm not going over the details of that now. In the interest of time, we can come back to in the discussion if you like. I think that it has now been confirmed with other genetic models that satellite cells are required for overload hypertrophy. And I also don't think that, as it has been suggested, it's related to age. But we can come back to that in the discussion if any of you are interested. So I think that at least for physiological models, there might be some molecular models where you influence the signaling systems related to muscle mass, but I think for physiological conditions, I don't think this route is important. Now, there was a problem connected to this, though. I wish it was possible to do it this way, because if you think about it, you have now a model where you can go from a thin to a thick fiber and recruit more nuclei, and you don't lose them when you go down to a thin fiber. And then if you go back up again, will you then kind of pump up your muscle each time you go back and forth? For people interested in bodybuilding or strength sport disciplines, that might be an interesting thought. But it didn't sound plausible, and it's probably not happening. And the experiment we devised to investigate that was the following. So there is now a rather classical model called hind limb suspension, where you lift the rat's tail up so that the hind limbs are up in the air, and they don't fight against resistance then, so they become less active, and you get muscle wasting. And when we did that, we observed that you went down without losing, as we expected, without losing any nuclei. But then we let the animal back down on the floor again. And when we did that, there was a rather dramatic regrowth. So there was almost 60% regrowth. And that would happen without adding new nuclei. And this has been confirmed, actually, by Charlotte Peterson's group in a similar way. So it's not that these nuclei are not required for a large fiber. It is because they are already there. So I think nuclei are required for de novo hypertrophy, but if you already have the nuclei there, you don't add on top of that unless you go beyond, perhaps, the size you had in the previous experiment. So this kind of made us suggest a model for my nuclei, which is sort of similar. I don't know if you use this anymore, if you use them in your country, but there used to be this kind of maximum thermometer where the mercury column here was pushing this little peg upwards, and it will leave it at the highest temperature the thermometer had ever experienced. It's like a high water tide mark, right? And similarly, it's possible that muscle fiber would have a number of my nuclei corresponding to the largest size that fiber have ever had. So, to summarize all this, so if you have slept so far, this led to a new model for us, suggesting that there is a first training route where you add myonuclei, and you don't lose these myonuclei when you detrain, but there is then a retraining route that is different, where you shortcut the step of the satellite cells and recruiting myonuclei. And this would then be your memory lane, if you like, or we haven't really shown, haven't really told you yet, whether this is just a phenomenon that is there, or whether this route is actually beneficial. Is it a beneficial memory? Is this shortcut easier than going this first time route here? And That question we sought to answer by giving female mice testosterone. And when you do that, you will see, and you see it even here without measuring, you will see an increase in cross-sectional muscle here, increase in the size of the muscle fibers. And we quantify that, of course. And you also see an increase in the number of nuclei. So the number of nuclei went up, and the fibers became larger. In addition, you could overload these muscles and get an additive effect on that, but I'll not talk about that right now. Now, this is the experiment we did. And so we had a peaking testosterone level, and that led to larger fibers compared to sham controls. Then if you remove the pellet with testosterone, then within 3 weeks here, maybe even earlier, but we only have these two time points, the size of the muscles went back to the control level. So they were indistinguishable in terms of size after 3 weeks here. But the number of nuclei remained high and was actually not significantly changed. So you lose your mass, but not your nuclei, by taking testosterone in this case, or the mice, I should say. Now, this didn't really show any form of long-term memory. So we did then a continuation of this experiment. I just described how we got large fibers and the fibers went back again to being small, but with lots of nuclei. But then we waited 3 months. 3 months, that's about 15% of the lifespan of these animals. And at that time, it's no surprise that there were no difference in size between the two groups. But the question is then, if you start now strength exercising or overload as we were using these animals, is there a more rapid or stronger growth in the nuclei-rich muscles that had seen the testosterone 3 months ago for a short period, compared to controls? So what do you think? Well, I probably would not have made a fuss out of it if it was anything interesting. And there was then a much stronger growth. So during the first 6 days, the nuclei-rich muscles, they grew 36%, and the control group grew only insignificantly 6%. So yes, there was a beneficial memory effect, if you like. Now, this, of course, made an impact on the doping debate. And it was for purely technical reasons that we used testosterone. It was not because we had a primary interest at the time in doping. Nevertheless, Science News picked this among the top 25 science news stories of the year 2013. Probably because of its doping implications. And not everybody was happy about it, so Justin Gatlin said to The Guardian that, for the few haters out there, seems like that's what they want to do, discredit my name and label me with laboratory rats in Oslo. So, then the question is, do exercise induce a muscle memory, or is it just testosterone? And we have some preliminary data on that. And Efter Sturley is having a poster on it this afternoon that you can go and look at. And this preliminary data, we need to analyze it more. But we wanted to combine, for reasons that I think you will understand in a minute or two, growing or young rats that were climbing and not climbing, or were kind of strength exercising and not strength exercising. And what you see here is that the climbing rats, they got more nuclei here. And even after detraining and growth, where both of them got more nuclei, the advantage, if you like, of the climbing rats remained. And when we then did a second exercise bout, you can see that the memory, it's not as strong as you would have hoped, but the memory group had larger fibers than the control group. And recently, so as of January, I think it was this year, Sharple's group published a paper in humans where they did exercise training. So they did 7 weeks of training, and then 7 weeks of detraining, where they where the muscle mass went back almost to baseline, and then with the retraining, they saw a stronger response. Now, they didn't count myonuclei, so I don't know what happened to that in this particular study, and they had, but they did the measurements of DNA methylation, and they are suggesting that memory could be related, in their case, to a hypomethylation event that lasted over the detraining period. That might well be, although I think we need more research to look at the functional importance of that, and I think that we need to think about protein synthesis partly in the terms of number of nuclei and partly in the terms of protein synthesis per nucleus, and of course the product of this would be the total protein synthesis, and balanced then with proteolysis, that would be how you can influence fiber size. So I think both these parameters might be important. So how long does, so if you go back to at least, if it is related to my nuclei, then how long does it last? How long does the muscle memory last? And that's the same, I think, if you believe in the my nuclei hypothesis, to ask how long does my nuclei last? And there's not much data on that in humans, but there is one study in Cell where they measured radioactive isotopes after nuclear explosions in the post-World War II era. And their estimate is that muscle tissue cells have 15 years half-life. And I think that is a low estimate for myonuclei because it would include also nuclei of other cells that have a more rapid turnover. So it's possible that the elevated number of nuclei is more or less permanent. But it's hard to do experiments over such long time periods, obviously. So I think if the time span is that long, I think this might have a bearing on the discussion about healthy aging. And I would like to bring your attention to the fact that these myonuclei are harder to recruit when you are old. And there's only a couple of papers here. There are many reasons for this, and I'm not going into the details about the mechanisms for that, but I think it is generally accepted that it is harder to recruit myonuclei when you're old compared to when you are young. So I think that the take-home message then would be that you want to start early. So it might be as a matter of public health advice that one should do strength exercise early, and maybe one could benefit from that when one gets older. As you know, sarcopenia, muscle weakness in the elderly is a major issue, sort of like the physical Alzheimer's, since we're discussing between muscles and brain here. So I think in summary then that we have a muscle memory, and the muscle memory encoding is done by sort of first time training, and the encoding is about getting more myonuclei, and then it's stored, the information is stored as an elevated number of nuclei, and then by a second training, even after detraining, could be a long detraining period, we can retrieve this or get the fruits of this, if you like, by retraining. And I think I'll end there just by mentioning that, so this is my group. So important people in this particular work has been Professor Jo Brusgaard, Ingrid Egner, and Einar Efterstøl, who are postdocs in my lab. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.